Good morning, everyone. I, Seema Bhatkar, branch mentor, IEEE VSIT student branch. Welcome you all to Mind Quench, the quarantine special webinar series by IEEE VSIT student branch. I hope everyone is well. Since the beginning of the webinar series, we have seen three wonderful series by eminent speakers. I would like to thank all of you for joining us here on day four, where we will shortly hear from Dr. Irfan Lange, Dean of Academic Affairs at MH Sabu Siddiq College of Engineering, on another very interesting topic. Before we begin, I would like to add a gentle reminder for all participants to keep their mic on mute and video off throughout the webinar. Ensure they have entered the webinar with their full name and use the chat box to ask questions, if any. We will be sharing the feedback form link in the chat box toward the end of webinar. Kindly ensure you submit your feedback before you leave the webinar. Now, I would like to invite our dearest Mr. Asif Rampurawala, Vice Principal, Vidyalanka School of Information Technology, to speak a few words. Sir.
Good morning, everyone. And welcome again to the fourth session of this lecture series organized by IEEE VSIT student branch. At the outset, let me thank Dr. Irfan Lange for accepting our invitation and, you know, enlightening us today on this very important, convergence of two technologies, if I may call it, of cloud computing and on IoT. And I don't think there's a better person than Dr. Irfan Lange to speak about this. And I'm sure that all the participants will gain a lot of insight into the actual applications of these technologies, from Dr. Irfan. I am also thankful to the organizing committee, Seema Bhatkar ma'am, very own Dr. Sarika Chauhan, for having, meticulously planned these sessions. The success of these sessions is visible in the number of participants from various institutions and the repeat. I always say that it's easy to get somebody, it's more difficult to keep them there. So, getting people again and again to come and join the lecture series is evidence of the success of these lecture series. So without wasting further time, and I know everybody is here to listen to Dr. Irfan, not to me. So all the best to everyone, and hopefully you all will have a great session. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. We shall now begin with today's webinar on role of cloud computing in IoT, will be delivered by Dr. Irfan Lange. He is the Dean of Academic Affairs at MH Sabu Siddiq College of Engineering, a senior IEEE member and fellow of IETE. He has been awarded a PhD in IT for security concerns in embedded systems and VLSI-based designs, and is a recipient of certificate in data science from IBM. Volunteered as mentor for IEEE India COVID MOOC online hackathon challenge, Fight Corona Ideathon organized by MHRD, Innovation Cell, AICTE, and Innovation Curies. He has conducted several training programs ranging from VHDL to embedded systems and IoT, Amazon Alexa, and intellectual property rights. Sir has received papers for FSDM, Fuzzy System and Data Mining Conference, and CECnet Conference on Electronics Communication and Networks 2019 at Kitayushu International Conference Center, Japan. Mr. Lange has also published two books and 16 job papers in journals and conferences, and has received the Best Paper Award twice. Sir, we are glad to have you for today's webinar. Now, I kindly request, sir, to take the session forward. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, madam. I think I am audible to everyone.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I again welcome all the participants for this webinar that is on the role of cloud computing and in Internet of Things. As Asif sir has rightly stated, there are two technologies which we are going to consider here in this one webinar. One is cloud computing and the other is Internet of Things. yesterday already there was one webinar which was conducted by Dr. Saurabh on his experiences with IoT. And as today's life which we are living, that is along with one or the other gadgets. So to some extent, we all are somewhere been connected with IoT. This is what is my point of view. So if you just think about the starting of the life and that too, presently, like due to this COVID scenario, we all are in our home and in the lockdown state. But at the same time, we have been getting connected across globe through the infrastructure which is available digitally. And this infrastructure, what we are using, that has been possible due to cloud computing. So even this meeting or this webinar is getting conducted, that is also on the cloud platform. So this gives us a very clear idea that the cloud computing is already been a part of our life. Similarly, because of the mobile phones and all other kind of activities which we are conducting, most of the time we use the word smart. So we use smart devices, and all these smart devices are nothing but IoT based devices, Internet of Things based devices. So in this webinar, I'll try my level best to deliver few points for everyone related to understanding the role of cloud computing in Internet of Things. Now, what are the takeaways from this webinar? I'll go for initially giving some idea about what actually IoT does. Because here, when you are going to think about why we should move to cloud computing, why the cloud is required when IoT itself is one complete system. So first we need to understand what actually the IoT does. And then we'll go for learning what is the role of cloud computing in IoT. After that, I'll give some idea with respect to the IoT cloud platforms which are available. And then finally, we will get the insights with the help of some use cases, and we will go for getting some idea about the limitations. So to start with, the first one, that is what actually the IoT does. So as I already stated, there are smart devices, and each smart device, we are going to consider that it is a IoT based device. So you can just try to imagine what are the different places where we are using practically IoT. So it might be a ticket booking, like how you are booking a ticket through some or the other kiosk which has been available through the smart card, or you may go for getting the ticket token at the metro stations. So there also we are using smart devices. Then if you consider the smart appliances, what we are using in home. So you may think about any smart oven or a smart refrigerator or any such kind of a smart appliances. Now, particularly, I will like to consider here a one point, and that is, now everyone is more concerned about, and that is healthcare. Because of this COVID-19, we all are having a more concern with the healthcare. And for your information, for almost the past 1 month, I am also working very actively in this field of providing the solution with the help of IoT and all other kind of, you know, smart kind of a solutions. In the other words, we can say we are fighting with the corona with the help of technology. That how we will use technology in order to get the solution. So If I ask you a simple question, that in your opinion, what do you think you will be using the IoT for fighting with Corona, for getting some healthcare solutions? You may come up along with the quick answers, thinking that, first of all, how you will detect the person is having Corona. So if you see, already in the media or on the news channels, you might have seen the thermal scanning is one of the things which has been used. So you are using the temperature scanning devices. So that is calling out the thermal scanning. And with the help of that, we try to detect one of the symptoms. So you know very well that nowadays, even we are going to have the information saying that the corona has become asymptomatic. So that is a different thing. But wherever the symptoms are there, how you are going to detect them? With the help of the smart devices. And if there is a reading which has been there on your temperature scanner, what you are going to do with that reading? How you'll go for remembering that information? Whether you will have the books of records getting created? So there are many challenges are there. And because of the nature of the disease, like we want to keep a distance. We do not want to physically touch anyone for carrying out any kind of examination. So in such kind of a scenario, how do you think the internet of technology is going to be useful? Whether it is only the IoT which is going to be useful? And my answer to this is no. You cannot just use IoT in order to get the solution. No doubt the IoT basically are nothing but three words, right? So what are those three words? Internet of things. So things are nothing but any kind of objects which you are using for making the actions to happen. And in order to make these actions to happen, you have to give some inputs. In reply of these inputs, you will be getting some outputs. And you need to go for using those outputs in order to take some decisions. So basically, when you talk about the IoT, what actually IoT does? So here, on this slide, if you see, I'm going for the what actually the IoT does. In this first one, vehicle, asset, persons, paid, and so many other things, you can see the IoT is mainly been focusing on monitoring and controlling. I'll not go into the much depth of this because my main talk is focused on what is going to be the role of cloud computing in IoT. So here, in order to understand what is the main concern of IoT is, we can see the first point over here, that is monitoring and controlling. So we go for monitoring and controlling. The next one is agriculture. If you see in the agriculture, there is automation. Then there is another one I place here, that is the energy consumption, security surveillance, building management. Then there are the devices like embedded, mobile, etc. There are M2M, that is machine to machine, and wireless sensor networks. There are several things which you are using in the everyday. So there might be like you are coming across your smart TV, a smart washing machine. There might be the different places which you are using some security kind of things that have been there. Even you are having nowadays smart shoes are there, smart wallets are there. Then you can even go for keeping a track of whatever the gardening which you are going to carry out or the plantation which you are going to carry out. Then there is like something called as the smart homes, smart cities. Then telemedicines, healthcare. So basically, if you even look around, nowadays we are getting, there are many things which with which we are getting connected and they are becoming smarter. So what actually you think the smartness is? What makes it smart? whether it is directly something like which you get in the market, which is readily been available as a smart from the manufacturer end. The answer is no. So what makes it smart? As you know, Internet of Things, IoT, things are nothing but the different objects which you are using. But what makes it smart? Is it that only the connectivity with the internet is going to make it smart? The answer is partially correct, but there are multiple other things are required, and after that only it can become smart. You can just simply try to understand with one point. So here I am having one word, that is agriculture automation. And here I am having a smart home or the smart city. Just take one example, a simple example. For the crops, you are going to give waters to them and you want to go for a water control. Similarly, in buildings, in your home, you require the water control. So when you are going for this water control, how actually it happens? Like in most of the buildings, wherever we are having a waterman, he opens the wall at a particular time, close the wall at a particular time. So this is like a manual one. You make it automatic. So when you make it automatic, how it happens? Like what is the automatic is? So what you will do is you will add some electronic system and you'll program it, stating that, okay, 10 o'clock is what the water wall is supposed to be open. 11 o'clock, it is supposed to be closed. So it is pre-programmed now. Okay. Once you turn on the system at 10 o'clock, the water wall will get open. Water starts filling, or it will get sprinkling over the whatever the agriculture crops are. And at 11 o'clock, it will stop. So is it smart or it is automated? You may call that it is automated. So what is smart then? In order to make it smart, let me say that, okay, I am at home and I want to go for carrying out the water control for the crops which are there in my farm. Or I may not be at home, but I know that the water is going to be, you know, the water wall will get open at 10 o'clock. And I have a reservoir or a water tank at my home, which is of a limited capacity, 1,000 liter or 1,500 liter. And there are the quite chances within a half an hour, my tank may get filled and it will overflow. And I just want this should not happen. So how I'll make it smart? I may go for making one app in my mobile phone, and through that app, I'll get connected with the electronic hardware, which I was using earlier for the automation. So the point over here is, there are three things which I had put very clearly. I hope everyone has understood. Because in the webinar, I cannot see your faces, but I just request that you can use the question and answer window and you can go on putting the intermediate questions which I keep on raising. So that maintains both of us connected with this particular webinar. And I hope I will be then successful in maintaining your attention with my webinar. So the point over here is, the one level was a manual where the man was simply opening and closing the wall. Second level was automated. In the automated, you had used the electronic device in order to go for opening and closing the wall instead of a man. You may use a kind of a timer which will keep on remembering that whether it is 10 o'clock in the morning when the water wall has to be open, 11 o'clock in the morning when it is to be closed. So you can see you have made it unmanned. That is automatic. Then the third thing is smart. So what does smart means? So in the smart, there is one more thing. And that is, instead of a timing of 10 to 11, I just want the user should go for deciding that at what time the water wall should get open and at what time the water wall should get closed. I want it should get closed at after half an hour only. I want to give that flexibility to the user. So when you are developing this app or maybe some interface through which you can command, you can control, you can monitor the activities which are happening. So basically, when you are making smart, you want that that there should be a good amount of inputs you should be able to give to your system so that the system can work as what your heart wants, as what you feel that it should work for. And when it works like that, I think you will be calling it as a smart system. So somewhere, once you tell it that, okay, you do it like this, then in the rest of the period, it will keep on performing that activity again and again, again and again, without any interference. So basically, when we talk about this IoT, one thing we understood that, no doubt, it is making it smart. But there is one more question. And that question is, you can just think, I am not allowing you to make any app. I'm not allowing you to interface with your IoT-based automated system through your mobile app. Or you can just simply try to guess how your mobile app is controlling it. Through the internet, or through Wi-Fi, or through Bluetooth. So that means there is some connectivity is required. My question to you again is, suppose that you want to go for controlling something. Nowadays, there is like one famous app or the activity which people were performing for the years down, and that was controlling their AC temperature with the help of an app which is available. So there you are not using directly internet, but there are some other kind of things are there. Like suppose that I want to, go on remembering the information that every time you are setting the temperature, on which day, what level of the temperature was set for your AC. Now I'm changing the example. I'm going for the AC temperature controller with the help of your mobile phone. So when you're setting the temperature, I just want to go for remembering this information that on day one, like now we are having a summer season, and I want, you should go on remembering key on 1st of May, what was your AC temperature, how much duration you are used the AC, how much energy was consumed, and like this, this entire log has to be maintained. So I should become a predictive. I should get connected with the weather forecast, and I should go for predicting you that, okay, at this time the AC should turn on. Probably if you keep it on the smart mode, then the AC should automatically turn on, AC should automatically turn off. It should guess that what is going to be the temperature, what is going to be the change in the weather condition, and according to that it should act. So what it is happening, it is becoming smart. How you'll make it happen? Can you just make it happen with the electronics? The answer is no. I can just give a simple example in order to understand this. To turn on and off the things, you can simply use a AND gate. Whenever both the things are true, the AND gate can turn it on. But when you want to give the user the more and more chances for giving the input, the more and more kind of the user interfaces, more ways of accumulating data, more ways of understanding and predicting on the basis of that data. Like what actually the IoT does. Let me go for summarizing it, because I had given the plenty of examples where I made you clear that just with the help of the simple electronic circuit, you may perform on and on operation, on and off operation. You may go for taking some decision, but if you want to become more predictive, if you want to become more analytical, if you want to go for giving the more better control, if you want to make it more smart, then it is not possible without going for something which is truly smart. So let me try to get the answer in the concise form now for what actually the IoT does. Here, in this particular slide, if you see, it says the Internet of Things is the inter-networking of physical devices, vehicles, buildings, and other items embedded with the electronic software, sensors, actuators, and network connectivity, which enables these objects to collect and exchange data. So here, like those two points, which are very important in the IoT. So when you say that IoT-based devices are smart, like what you are, I think you are also smart, right? So when you are learning this technology for the betterment of the humankind, so that's why I'm calling that you are smart. So here, when you will become a smart for taking the decisions, only when you will collect the data, you will exchange that, you will interpret that, you will analyze that, and on the basis of that, when you will take the decisions which are going to be better for the humankind. And that's why, if you see, being an IEEE member, like the tagline of the IEEE is technology for the humanity. So we need to go for using the technology for the humanity as being an engineer or the students of the science and technology. And this particular field, IoT, Internet of Things, is just opening the doors for us in order to use the technology and the data science in order to go for getting the different ideas in the reality so that we can provide the solutions for the betterment of the humankind. So to conclude with this particular point, that what actually the IoT does. So the IoT collects the data, exchanges the data, and on the basis of these two things, collection of the data and exchanging of the data, the IoT is going to help for taking the decisions in the smart manner. So I hope, if I ask the question again, what actually the IoT does? I hope you all are ready with the answer, okay? I'm sorry for the repetition, but that is what is very important to understand, that what is the role of a cloud computing in IoT. Otherwise, the IoT itself is completely capable of handling right from the response till the action, everything. When the user gives the input, till it takes the action, everything has been possible. So here, like the several use cases are mentioned, which I'll be discussing at the end, like home or the consumer, transport, mobility, health, or buildings, infrastructure, cities, industries. You may have quick examples, like if you talk about the home or if you talk about the consumer, nowadays you are in the lockdown and you are expecting that the whatever the online orders which you are going to place, they should be delivered at your place without any issue. You are just thinking about the one side of it. And what is that? You are just thinking about, okay, that someone is going to pick the order and he will be carrying it and it is going to be dropped at your home. But what about the background thing? There is a lot of logistic is involved. There is a lot of inventory control is required. So there are so many operation controls are there. And at each place, there can be the IoT is used for the betterment or the better control of the inventory and all other processes. Similarly for the transport, like you think you want to go for traveling from one place to the another place, you can go for booking a cab. Now, depending upon in which zone you are, there might be a restrictions are been still been imposed on the Ola, Uber cabs or some other taxi services. But when you consider in the normal situation, you know very well that key with the help of your that app, you are booking it. And there are like, if you go for the automated one, like I'm using Amazon Alexa in order to go for carrying out the cab booking, then you are using a voice interface over here. So when you are getting connected with the world earlier, you are using keyboard, keys. After that, you are using touch. Now you are using voice. So the interfaces are changing. And with the help of this change in the interfaces, we want the user should give the response or the inputs. So in the transportation, already we have started using the different interfaces. Then in the healthcare, already I talk about the healthcare care kind of things which we can use even for fighting with corona. Then in the building, already I had given the example of the water level control. There are several automated SCADA and data acquisition systems are there. And when you consider the different buildings which are in the smart manner and whatever the needs of the city, like including the the maintenance of gardens, maintenance of the societies, maintenance of roads, maintenance of traffic, all these things when you maintain in a smart way, we are going to get the smart cities. So this shows that okay, everywhere the IoT is being used. So now the question is, why we should go for the cloud then? What is the role of a cloud in the IoT? So if you recollect, I was having one important point in my previous slide, and that was the IoT was having a concern with data. Sorry, my handwriting is not too good with mouse writing. But this word is very much important for us because you cannot make your devices smart unless you have a data. And whatever the decisions you are going to take, that has been based on data. Just take the example. Suppose that you are using some, a COVID detection or some temperature detection. And for that, you are making some kind of IoT-based device. Then you go for a temperature screening. So there is one threshold, right? When that particular threshold, maybe in Fahrenheit or maybe in Celsius, that particular threshold is been considered for taking a decision. What you will make out that when your screen shows a temperature value matching to that XYZ value, you'll consider that, okay, the person may be probably been infected. Or if it has been below that, the person probably may not be infected. Maybe it's particularly related to the fever. I'm just stating. So the point is what? That information is nothing but a data. I want an automated system. That is, a person should just walk in, There is a sensor which has been fitted. I want a person should walk in and he is going to stand at one particular position. From his temple, that particular temperature is getting read. So it is contactless temperature reading. The process is automated. You don't have to stand along with, holding that particular thermal scanner. Automated thing is there. So once that reading matches a particular value, you go out and you come to know that, okay, this particular person has been detected with fever or not detected with fever. Now there are continuously people are just moving in, and their flow is like very large. And because of like this large flow of people, you cannot make a human to keep on recording the things. Rather than that, we just want the recording should keep on happening automatically. At the time of the entry gate, the person was just giving you some information, and one of the information in that was mobile number. When the person was going out of the screening, on that is mobile, whatever the temperature value and whatever the the diagnostic conclusion is there or the probable conclusion is there, that has been sent either through a message or through a SMS. So that means we are having the record of information. How did you like my point? Don't you think that yes, with the help of handling the data in the right manner, you can make a lot to happen? So the point over here is, when you consider the data, is it that IoTs cannot store the data? Yes, IoTs can store the data. But my question to you is, when you are fighting with this pandemic, how much data is getting generated? A huge amount of data is getting generated. And what you're using at the primary level for collecting that data, you're using IoT. So how you will take the decision for that huge amount of data in a fraction of a second? There is something which you require, which will be more quicker, more faster. And at the same time, it should be more, huge in order to store the amount of data. The first thing which I brought it to very clearly to your notice. That is the huge amount of data. It's not that the data cannot be handled with the IoT. Yes, you can handle the data, but that was limited amount. So huge amount of data is required to be handled as we are increasing the connectivity of the IoT devices. If you see in my previous slide, there is like the prediction is around 200 billion devices. Now we are getting that even the trillion devices are going to get connected. So along with this, when you consider, that is very clear that the number of devices which are getting connected, they are increasing. And from each data, each device, there is a data. And on that data, you are going to take the decision. So that data, how you are handling, how you are going to process, what you are going to do with that data, that is very important. So it requires some storage for that. The another thing is security. So IoT devices are not considered with, the very high level of a security. This is another thing. So primary level, if you consider that why you want to go for using cloud computing. The two points I have very clearly given. One is the D for data, and that is S for security. With the help of cloud security, you can make your IoT-based devices more secure. So is it that only these things are important? The answer is no. The other thing is, as you are growing your business with the IoT, we require a bigger infrastructure, a larger infrastructure. So as you require a bigger, a larger infrastructure, and you want to get connected with multiple type of customers, you cannot go on growing your infrastructure in one day. It requires time. And there is a competition in the market. So you need to meet that competition also. So how you will make your product launch into the market in the less time, as it will be getting even discussed in the later slide also. So that is also more important. So basically, we want a readily available infrastructure which can help us in order to make, the growth possible. One example, I can just give a quick example that is like you may consider. Earlier, like everyone was having like going for the personal car. But nowadays, you know very well that the car has been considered only for the status or for the luxury mode. Otherwise, we are having the cab aggregators like Uber, Ola has been available. So people started already thinking that whenever already you can rent a car for whatever the amount of time for which you want to hire it, why you should go for purchasing it, and then you can have the liabilities like the maintenance and all other stuff. Rather that, you just book it, use it, and then pay and get rid of it. That's all. Similarly, the cloud is providing you a readily available infrastructure which you can rent, which you can use, and you can just go for using some other things. So for whatever the services which you want, for that you can just use the cloud services. Like here you can see there are the infrastructures, there are the different platforms, there are the different applications. So if I consider the point here, then it is IPA. So we can use the cloud for the different infrastructure, platforms, applications which are readily available. So in conclusion, if we just think from this particular slide, then you can see whatever the way you want to get interface, either through the laptop or through the phone or through the tablet or through the desktop, whatever the way of getting connected is with the cloud, you can get connected through anything. You can have your devices getting connected with your laptop. You can have the wireless devices getting connected to your laptop, your tablet, your mobile phone. And through this, you can just make the devices further to get connected with the cloud. So that means the cloud connectivity is with ease. And because of this, in my opinion, I think we are having slowly a more and more dependency on the cloud. Let's go ahead. If I go for putting the summary for the role of cloud computing in IoT, the first thing is scalability. What is the scalability? In simple words, you can either scale up or scale down. You can increase or decrease. So when you are being a new one in the market, you may be having only one customer or 10 customer or 100 customer, and you can go on slowly increasing the number of zeros. So suppose that you want to make your, you know, a water tank control system, something with which your family members may be very happy that you have done something on your own. How many units you are going to make? Only one? Maybe your building people also want the same thing. How many units you'll make? 10? Now, if you are going to have the more orders, how many units are required? 100, 1,000, 10,000? If you want to earn money, are you going to stop yourself only with the 1 or 10 or 100 orders? Obviously, no. So basically, you want to scale up. And when you go for scaling up, you will have a dependency on this readily available infrastructure. And that is nothing but the cloud computing. Another point is, how much dependency will be there? So even for that, we are having a convenience. It's not that for each and every service, you require the complete dependency on the cloud. You can have the dependency is to the amount, whatever you want. If something is required just for the sake of, you can just use it for the small time, and then you can just get disconnected from it. So there is a scalability available, not just from the infrastructure perspective, from the services perspective also it has been available, from the platform users perspective also it has been available. So whatever the amount you want to contribute from your end, you can do that. Whatever the amount of efforts you want the cloud company to take care of, you can just ask the cloud company to take care. Obviously, this everything is at the payment. Most of the time it is pay per use. Next, it is connectivity. Already I told you that anything with an internet connected can become smart, but you call it as smart because of the decision making. If the decision makings are not smart, then it is not really smart. So already I had shown in my previous slide, okay, you was getting connected with the cloud with the help of the different kind of gadgets which are available easily with you. I already told you about the time to market. There is a competition. So you cannot just go on, you know, carrying out the experimenting. Most of the time people just, you know, carry out the experimenting and they are like in the search of a proper sensor, a proper protocol or some other thing for launching a product in the market. And in this only, making that all the things are arranged on your shop floor, on your table, it takes a lot of time. By that time, someone else is going to launch a product in the market. So if you do not have a market to capture, then how you will survive, how you will sustain? And because of that, the time to market is very important. And the cloud is going to help you to go for putting the efforts for integrating the things and use whatever the things are which are been readily available. So the time to market, obviously, it gets reduced. Then the data mobility. You can have the aggregation of a large amount of data. So the cloud is not making you that you should share each and every, a bit and byte, each and everything you should share on their cloud platform. It's left to you. You may handle some amount of data locally. There is no restriction. You can even have a local server. The point will be coming in the discussion in the next thing. So there is a data mobility and yes, security. Already I told you that why you want to go on the cloud. One is data. Second is security. Third is it is readily available. So DSR. So that is, we are having a data which is getting handled by the cloud. Security is getting handled by the cloud and are ready to work. Platforms that have been available. So security, cloud-based security we can use. Then there is ease of integration. So it is not that the learning curve is very steep. Here the learning curve is not very steep. So you can go for having the adaptability with whatever the platforms which are available. So there is the ease of integration is available. And since you don't have to pay huge amount, reason is, as already I had given the example of hiring a cab or a car for the just a small ride, how much you pay? You are not going to pay lakhs of rupees because you are not purchasing car. Already the infrastructure is available, the driver is available, the cab is available, it is well maintained. You just go for paying for that amount of duration for which you are using the cab. So that's why even in the cloud computing, as you are going to pay as per your use, if you are using it for the less amount of time, you are going to pay less. If you are going to use it for the more, you will be paying more. But even though whatever the payment is, you, if you consider the time to market, another advantage, the data handling, the security, if you try to make this entire infrastructure on your own, it is going to take a huge amount of capital amount. But instead of that, here, like, you get an advantage that with the cloud, we can get the more better solution in less price. I hope I've been able to make my point very clear with the scalability, connectivity, and other kind of points. Okay, you can go for using the cloud computing. Now, apart from this, there are few more things which we need to keep in mind. I have repeatedly stated, okay, it's not that it is compulsory you should go on cloud. There is no compulsion. You can have the IoT itself is one independent system. Another thing is it that when you go on the cloud only, then you will be getting the huge servers and all other stuff? Answer is again, no. It's not that you need to move on the cloud only for the servers. You can have the servers available even in the IoT. Local servers you can have. But still, there are some of the other challenges are there. I just tried to list it here, the few challenges, that is IoT software development challenges. So basically the thing is, when you want to go for developing the, you know, that smart kind of things, you are having the first thing, choosing the right operating system. If I talk about what is the operating system you are using in your IoT devices, you may be going to talk about some or the other RTOS, real-time operating system, which comes into embedded. So that means now again, there is a relation between the embedded and IoT. Now the point over here is whether whatever the OS which you are going to use that is going to allow you the better control. The answer is no. If you go for using a particular OS, you know, it might be having a limitation. Those limitations may not be directly imposed by the OS. I repeat, those are not the direct limitation of the OS. Most of the time, those are nothing but the limitations due to memory. Due to memory. Again, repeat. Most of the time, whatever we design in embedded system, in IoT, they are being constrained due to memory. So the device which I mentioned here, that is nothing but a memory most of the time. Simple point is there. Just take one simple example. You have been familiar with so many desktop operating systems. And you want that key, you want to, you know, install one of the best Windows version or similar kind of a version in your mobile phone. Can you do that? The answer is, again, no. Why? Because there is a restriction due to memory. That is the first thing. And then the other thing due to the processing and all other kind of hardware infrastructure. So this is very clear here. Okay, when you are going for the OS, there are the limitations due to the choice of devices, what you are going to do. Because when you are designing the IoT base or the embedded based systems, they are task oriented, they are application oriented. The whatever the, you know, kind of OS and the devices which you select, that is for performing a specific task. Meaning is, if you are going for, you know, temperature control, you'll use a temperature sensor along with whatever the system which you are designing. But if you want to go for a flow sensor, that at what speed my water is flowing, obviously, the temperature sensor cannot be used. So this gives a very clear idea that there is a high constraint on whatever the devices which you are using, and these devices are getting communicated through the OS. So obviously there is a limitation, restriction on the OS. Next is selecting the right gateway. So is it that key you have just, you know, considered or you are in everything, then the things can be done? Answer is again no. You require a right gateway, okay, in order to go for finding out a solution. I'll just get here the another slide for the better understanding. You can see here, in this one, we have sensors, actuators. What they do? You know very well, data sampling. Data sampling, they collect the samples. So it is like the value of temperature, value of flow, value of pressure. I don't have to talk much about it. Then there is going to be some devices for the processing. So you may be having some sensors, some boards, something like this. This everything is nothing but in your first phase, phase one. So in the phase one, what you will do? You will just sample the data. Okay, you make your processor to get connected with that data through some interface. In that interface, there is one thing called as analog to digital converters. And you want that this data should be shared with the cloud. And for that, you require someone who is going to process this data in some or the other way so that it can be communicated to the cloud. And for that, you require some connecting means. You may go for considering, you know, like when you are going for making some online transactions, you want to get connected with some banking website. And you might have seen that when you are getting connected through your router, it provides you the access through a gateway. So it is simply nothing but that gateway, which is having some kind of a set of rules, the protocol, some system. But what is the main thing it is going to do? It makes everything understandable by the end part, that is nothing but the cloud over here. So I hope you got a fair idea. Now the another thing is security. Already I stated repetitively that IoTs are not that much secure. How you weigh the securities? You just consider the securities with the perspective of password. Most of the people are just thinking that, okay, I am just going to have a password security. Now you are having in your smartphones, there are smart locks. So you consider the security with the help of face recognition, maybe some pattern recognition or something like that. As you all are, I think, are the students or the people who are being interested in the field of information technology, computer science, data science, or something allied to it, you know very well that all these things, whenever you are considering, they are not completely secure because there may be some hackers or some malicious components or something like that through which there can be attack. So sometimes what happens is if one of the device, one of the connection in your IoT is been cracked, is been hacked, then through that you can get the data of the entire system. So you can simply understand from this how much severe impact the security can give. And because of that, like, you know very well, you want to enter into the market as quickly as possible. So even for the testing and all, the things are getting compromised. And because of that, we do not have enough time to get more security testings. So it is better to move on the cloud. Then there are the quality assurance challenges are there. So there are the use cases at the end, we will see about that. Then you want the different user interfaces. You want a user friendliness. With the IoT interface, so there is a limitation. So with the help of a cloud, you are having more options are there for making the UIs available, UX available, that is user experiences. Cross-platform deployments are there. So as you are using the different apps on the different platforms, on the different hardware, Like, for example, you are having iOS, you are having the Android base. So the cross platforms are there, and you may go for getting that your devices are operating over it. So by this time, we got a clear idea about what the why we should go on the cloud. Now, when you talk about the cloud infrastructure, I will just quickly go through it. We know that for any cloud, there are the at least three things we consider: SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS, infrastructure as a service. So here, when you talk about the infrastructure as a service, the key features what we get is readily available, the hardware has been there, and you can just go for paying it based on whatever are your requirement. This infrastructure is scalable depending upon what are your processing are there. It can save you on in terms of cost. It can make the data is been available on the cloud, so you don't have to go for any failure of the system. Everything has been integrated on the cloud. It enables the virtualization, so you don't have to go for taking care of any additional stuff on your end. Everything is easily available. You can just go for using it. If you go for PaaS, that is platform as a service, it enables the organizations to focus on the development. So what a platform is giving, the platform is going to give the tools to test and develop and host the applications in the same environment. So you don't have to worry about all the things, you know, to be arranged on your platform. Rather, you can just get it from the platforms of the service provider. They can manage the securities, operating systems. Then they can provide a collaborative work. So all the flexibilities has been there. So these inputs has been taken from the IBM Think Academy. So there are the lot of information has been available even online, which you can get from this respect. I'm just interrelating the points. Now, if you think about comparing the traditional IoT and a cloud-based IoT, so we can have the few points like server, data storage, authentication. So if you talk about server, is it that in the traditional IoT you cannot have a server? My answer is no, you can have a server even in the traditional IoT as well as the cloud-based IoT. But here the server is more like a dedicated one, whereas here you are having the servers which are like the huge, you can use it or you can remain on that platform as far as whatever your requirements are there. You can have a limited data storage, whereas here you can have the data storage to the huge. So in these two points, you can see there is nothing like no. It is yes, but there is a limitation. But here you can see there is no limitation. There is a lot of, amount of information is available over there. If you see the next one that is related to the connection. So authentication and connection. As I said, how you are going to do the authentication through the password. So most of the time it can be easily compromised. Whereas here you can have, there is like the cloud security is there. Then you can have the connection can be like anything, can be just simply plug and play kind of thing. Whereas in the cloud base, there can be a set of rules are there. So that means this gives us a more better security. Whereas here, when you talk about the security, there can be a bit compromise in that security. Similarly, when you go for the device identification, most of the time, we cannot make the, you know, the device identification for each and every device. Whereas here, it has been easily been possible. Edge computing, at the end, I will be coming to this. But most of the time in a traditional IoT, you may have a local servers, but we do not go for a particularly like edge computing, but some people most of the time use even this word. So edge computing. So as at the end, I will give you the idea. So you yourself can decide whether it is possible in a traditional IoT or not. But in the cloud-based IoT, yes, we use it. Application isolation. Most of the time, it has been very difficult in the traditional IoT, whereas here it has been easily been possible, but there can be some restrictions. On the air updating or the software development kit maintenance. So most of the time you need to go for releasing the updates. So these updates are for upgrading the user interface or user experience. You know that once you develop the embedded based system, then your hardware is already been decided. And because of that, there is like not much upgrade is possible in this. A limited one is possible. Whereas here, it can be done to a larger extent. So if you move next, here I discuss it into the big detail. Already I have given you the idea. So I'll just go for quickly going through the points. So here, like I told you about the traditional IoTs and this thing. So finally, like if I consider again, the main point, that role of a cloud computing, I hope to some extent, I made it very clear that there is a scalability, connectivity, time to market, data mobility, security, ease of integration, and finally, there is a cost effectiveness. So what are the different platforms which are available? As I'm running short of the time, I'll just go for quickly wrapping it up. So there are the Amazon Web Services, IBM Watson, Microsoft, Google, Oracle, and there are many, many, many companies are there. Even you are having the open source platforms are also been available nowadays in order to go for, carrying out the development. So if you visit Amazon.com, you will get that there is the Internet of Things, under which you can see there are several, there is a IoT core under which you can have the connect devices to the cloud, AWS Green Glass, through which you can go for local compute messaging. So you are having even for the creation of the button. So that means we have the platforms which are very rich with their services. So you do not have to be bothered about, like if you go visit Google, then in the Google, like you can see the build and train ML models. This is one of the, screenshot I have taken. So I just want to put here the point that it's not that only Google is providing you ML. All the cloud providers are providing you AI tools, ML tools. And I want to just make it very clear. If you want devices more smart, so it is not that AI and ML cannot be the part of the IoT. As with the help of a cloud, we are going to take the decisions. And because of that decision, the things are going to become smart. We can use AI, we can use ML, we can use DL, we can use multiple kind of things in order to make our decision making more and more smart and accurate. Even Microsoft Azure is also been there. You can see there are several tools are there. And in my opinion, you all are quite lucky, because if you just simply go for a bit Googling, you'll come to know that there are a lot of courses are also been available online through the good platforms. And you may go for getting a hands-on or try if you want to get into really the practicality, or even you can get connected with me, okay, for the more information in order to take the decisions, okay? Or you want to go for carrying out something development, okay? Because unless you do the things practically, you are not going to learn. That is what you need to keep in mind. You cannot learn the swimming just by doing a course or just by reading a book. You need to do it practically. So if you go for comparing these three platforms, as it has been given on in one of the thing, so you can see the IoT pass or the SDKs mainly, we are going to use the platforms for getting the different protocols. Like you can see the different messaging supports are already been there. Okay, I just consider your three which were available quickly, so that's why I just put it over here and even mention from where it has been taken. This was just an idea. So this gives us a clear idea that on the cloud, everything has been available. Now, in order to go for concluding this session, let me give you the quick point related to the use cases and the limitations. So here, like the one with which we all are having a concern. So there will be like a one complete webinar can be conducted on the, the use cases, particularly on the healthcare. I just mentioned here, nowadays, you want everything should be mobile. Everything should be available in your mobile phone. And that's why we call it as IoMT. That is internet of mobile things. And in the other words, technically it has been used as internet of medical things. So basically, now the mHealth is becoming more and more popular. I just considered here the 4 points in these use cases: remote patient monitoring, mobile health, smart hospital, chronic disease treatment. You may think about one of the wearable, wearable band, and through that you are transferring the data to the mobile. You know very well that there are the sensors which has been attached into this, and you are getting the data. Based on that data, you are predicting that how many calories may get burned, how many calories are so far been burned, what are the health tips which has been there. Maybe you are getting some reminders has been set in order to get few steps of walk or something like that, or there can be a reminder for the pills, or there may be the reminders, those who have been suffering from diabetes, they may be having a reminder related to their insulin, or those who are suffering from a chronic disease, they may be having some or the other, the parameter check that can be considered over here. So there are the different ways in which you can get connected. You just try to visualize in the background how the things happens. Unless until you think how the things happen and how you will make it happen, you will not get the main point, and that is the role of cloud in IoT. So if you understand at the first level, from your this variable band, you are generating the data. You want to process that data. You want to predict. You want to give certain tips, health tips. Then this huge amount of thing which you need to do on the basis of the inputs which are dynamically changing, you yourself can make out, yes, the cloud is required. Or rather, the cloud can make it simple to launch the product which can be more better than whatever is existing. In this past hackathon, I come across several teams in which we have discussed a lot of ideas in order to get the health-based solution with the help of IoT and the cloud in order to go for maintaining the social distancing and all other things. I'll not talk much at this particular moment of time as we are running short of the time. So for the health, we think that there are a lot of advantages which we get. So in simple words, with the IoT, you can get efficiency in using the things at home, at industry. It will save your time, save your money, save the energy. Whereas at the same time, there are the certain limitations which you have in IoT. That is, privacy implications are there. Already I told you that security is an issue. Autonomy and control concerns, they may not be as smart as what you are expecting. The data storage is limited. Okay. The security and safety, the devices can be hacked, they can be attacked. So there are the several issues are there. Environmental impact are there due to the carbon footprints and all, okay, of the electronic devices. But when it comes to the cloud, you can have the data analytics can be done with the help of a cloud. You can have a better management support can be there. You can have your smart home or the consumers. Smart home and consumer are just the two examples which are given here. Otherwise, you can have multiple kind of examples can be considered in this. So if you talk about the smart home, like you can see, there are the devices, okay, which have been connected over here. And through that, like there is a camera, there are the refrigerators or something like that. And these devices are connected to the cloud and they are trying to provide you the remote control, remote security, or the intelligent energy uses. So if you talk about, this is one of the use case, which I will consider a bit in a couple of minutes, that is for the smart home. Okay, it has been taken from the intechopen.com, that is given very nicely. So I taken it from there. I already mentioned the source on the slide. So here you can have the different kind of things has to be done. Already I told you that when you will call your home as a smart home, obviously when your decision making is smart, if you do not take the smart decision, then you are not going to consider that it is a smart home. And for that, you are having the different sensors. They have been connected through the local area network. There, this network, you can see this network is connected to your devices through this IoT appliances and event managing. Okay, it is been connected to the smart home server. It has been connected to the database. So if you see, already I told you that it's not that you cannot have the local server available, or you cannot have the the local database available. You have a local database, you have a local server. So it's not that in the IoT you cannot make a local system. You can make it, but still there is a dependency on the internet or the cloud, because of already I had explained to you role of a cloud, which gives in short the data handling, the security, the ready to use platform, DSR. Okay, so the user now, rather than directly getting connected to this, you know, the local system, can be connected through the internet and the cloud. Earlier, like if this is not there, the user was getting connected through the internet to this system. So this was not there if you don't use the cloud. So what you can see, there is only one thing is added, that is a cloud. But with this one thing, you have infinite things, because as you know, the technology is getting more and more mature. The people are adding more and more services. That's why I use the infinite word. Otherwise, you may say that many different services are there available on the cloud. So in order to quickly wrap up here, like already the example is elaborated with the six components: the home control, the processor API, the home appliances IoT, the internet for the connectivity, already in the previous slide you have seen, the cloud for the computing, and the user. So first thing is the user through the internet connected with the entire interface. So through the cloud, it can go for interacting with the smart home. And then you can see this IoT can communicate through the internet to the cloud, as well as there is an interface of the smart home server API. So basically, we need to understand how the things are interconnected. So here you are having the home control device. That is the first one. But you know very well that everything starts over here and ends over here. And to make it happen, this entire thing is considered. Let us consider the first implementation scenario. I'll just go quickly. So the water leak and its prevention has been considered, the overflow of water. In case the water sensor detects the leak, so you can see the point number 3. So in case the water sensor detects the leak, it goes to 3. That is, the home appliances IoT will send an event to the hub. How it is sending? It is sending directly, you can see. Next is, it controls the application, so which triggers the turn wall off application. So it triggers the turn wall off application. The home control application then sends a turn off command to IoT 3. So it will go for sending it through the IoT 3. Then this can go further, and it will be informing to the IoT, this home control device. And finally, the update message will be sent to the user that yes, it has been turned off. So I quickly just repeat in few seconds, if there is an overflow of water, it has been detected by your home appliance, it will be informed to your processor, it is going to take the action through the actuator, valve will turn off, this information will be shared with your home control device, this entire thing will be shared through the cloud to the user, and the user will be updated. Okay, the next one is, if I consider there is some fire broke and you require a smoke detector, then for that we can have, whenever there is a smoke detector is there, okay, so you are been out from the home, so you are not knowing that what had happened in the home. So here this particular actuator or a sensor which has been there, that turns on and it detects that there is smoke Once it has been detected, it will be informed to the home control device, okay? And this home control device will go for issuing the signal or the action taking so that the fire can be exhausted and accordingly the alert can get generated. Next is, if you go for having a management to control the home appliances. So in your absence for the long time, there are the chances that some of the appliances may get hit up. So if one or the other appliance has been detected with, getting heated, then there will be a sensor, like what you are having in your, kettle, automatic kettle, that is the temperature is there, and once it reaches to that temperature, it is auto turn off feature. So if similar kind of a sensor is there, the actuator will come into the action. It will inform to your home appliance IoT system that automatically the sensor is supposed to turn off it so that the further damage can be controlled. So you can see, it's not that we can just use it into the home appliances. You can use it even in the digital production, that is what you call nowadays at the industry 4.0. In the physical production, as well as for the digital production, because there, you are connected with suppliers, logistics, computer servers. You may go for having customization of the product, virtual production, smart production. So all the advantages are there just by adding the cloud to your IoT. Now, we have come across the word edge computing. So here, we need to keep in mind that most of the time it is considered that there is a latency. Latency is nothing but the amount of time required for sending the signal and getting the response. So the fact over here is, if you are having a fire breaking in your home and there is a latency for sending the signal from home to the cloud, then from the cloud to the home back for controlling the thing, or for the same thing like in the building you are going to have a fire has been broke. So what are the things which you want to happen? Don't you think that if there is a smart fire extinguishing system is there, you want that that fire extinguishing system should come immediately in the action. And at the same time, the fire brigade should also be informed. So what we want over here is, we want some system to be there which is to play a role for the immediate action, along with the similar kind of advantages which we have with the cloud computing. And for that, a layer similar to the cloud, the infrastructure similar to the cloud, is been created, and we call it as the edge computing, fog computing, or even you may be going to call it as a dew computing. So basically, depending upon the complexity of the infrastructure, depending upon the time base, how much time is required, the closeliness in terms of time, how much is the latency time, we can go for having an infrastructure and we can call it as a edge computing, fog computing, or the dew computing on the basis of that. So as the solution is concerned and the complexity is concerned, obviously, it is very clear, edge can be less complex compared to the cloud, fog can be less complex compared to the cloud, and so on. So when you talk about the end devices, these end devices can be the edge devices. And they have the capability of even taking the decisions at their own end. If they can't, then they may go for getting connected with the fog. If they can't, they may go for getting connected with the cloud. So there may be some huge amount of data which is lying over here, and you just require some quick amount of data just to take a decision. You may take a decision here itself, or you may take a decision only at the end device level. So it's not that if you have been dependent upon the cloud, that means you should remain connected with the cloud for each and every decision. It's not like that. There is a flexibility. So I hope with this particular point, you have got some idea, and I was able to maintain your interest for this almost for the past 1 hour 10 minutes I was talking. So I think he was not that much bored. So anyway, I'm going to open now for the questions. And if you want to get connected for any kind of things you want to explore, so I'm already been there on the mentors board of IEEE also. And I am more than happy to help the people to grow and learn with the technology. So from my end, I just have a welcome for all of you to get connected. So it has been left to you. Okay. Thank you very much for listening to me for the past 1 hour, almost 10 minutes. Thank you very much. Yes, madam. Over to organizers.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. It was a delight listening to you as you shared the valuable technical information with us. We would now like to present some questions that students have asked. The first question, what would be the impact of the IoT on the job market? Do you see any possible job cuts? This question is from Parth A.
What was the question? The question was the impact of the cloud computing in the job market.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. See, as during my talk, already I stated that if you just consider, this is like a bunch where the cloud is a kind of an infrastructure which has been available. But to use the services which has been available on the cloud, you require some or the other skill set. Like if you are going for AI, you are going for ML, you are going for some core IoT. So that skill set is required. So even though like you need to just think that okay, where you want to go, whether you want to join the companies which are providing the cloud-based services, or you want to join the companies who are providing the applications which are in real time. Based on that, there will be a more clarity because the cloud-based companies are also expecting people to know the cloud architecture, then how to deal with the cloud infrastructure, getting interface, connectivity, because these cloud companies also want the manpower or the resources to get connected with the developers who have been on the application end. So I think that there are the several skill set which has been open nowadays, and all these skill sets, like either in the field of AI, ML, DS, deep learning, or particularly the cloud architecture, or all these kind of things can be considered. And then slowly, like you can go for getting the deep dive into it. I think I am able to answer the question.
Yes, sir. Thank you. So next question from Vineet Kotak, sir. Which specific cloud platform will you personally recommend for IoT, specifically for educational?
So basically, this question which has been asked, that is like, it is a very good question, like for the education purpose, which platform you can go for. So here, like for the education purpose, it is main concern is how quickly you can learn and how much support you are getting from the the companies who are having that platform. I think these two points has to be considered. So it's difficult for me to particularly point to one of the company, but I think in my slides I have given the several companies, and all of them, like if you go for AWS, they are also allowing you to open a free account. They give you some credit. Along with that, you can go for exploring yourself. Similarly, like the Google Cloud. Now, even there are like the online courses, they have been thrown open to the students. So I think for the education field at this moment of time, particularly like there is a blessing in disguise. And it is nothing but okay, there are like even the discounted or almost free courses has been getting offered by most of the cloud service providers. So I think I had answered it to some extent, because presently like most of the companies are giving the support to the education institutes. Even like if you go through the company's websites, the service provided websites, they are having a special agreement or the sort of services for the education domain, in which they give you certain cloud credits in order to go for exploring their services. And I think the education based people can take the advantage of it. Yes, madam.
Yes, sir. Sir, we will take the last question now. Okay. From Vandana Krishna Rao from VSIT. What professional roles are there in cloud computing, and what skills can we develop as students to set on the path of these roles?
So basically, I think already I answered this question in the first question itself. Yes. Because there is no particular path. It's like your interest, because the cloud is nothing but an infrastructure. So in that infrastructure, you are going to have the different kind of layers, different kind of services are there. So you may start as a cloud architecture architect, or you may go for, you know, starting like just there are some beginners courses are there. You can learn, because now, like in this COVID situation, they are allowing you to do certain kind of, you know, their platform exploration without spending much, or even without spending a penny. So for a student who are in final year, they can particularly, you know, try to enhance their skill set with the help of any of these six things: AI, ML, DS, or cloud, IoT, embedded, and then they can go for integrating it. Because here, like, the two group of things has been there, and any one of these also, you become expert, you can use that in all the six kind of domains. This is what is my personal perspective. Depends upon the job openings, it may a bit varied. So I think and everywhere, like if you see Python, it's not that you cannot do anything in using Python in IoT. You can do. So that means there is a common skill set with all these open source tools which you can use, as well as this platforms you can explore, and no need to go for hopping on the platform. Stick to one platform, explore it, go to the one or the two labels. Like, first you start with understanding the architecture, then you go for learning the services, then you think of how to make a small application. So for a student, it is better to try hands-on, and there are some simulation kind of things are available. So it is not that you require a core hardware only to make the things. Yes, madam.
Okay, very well, sir. Said, sir. So those were all the questions. Thank you. Now I request Khushi to present vote of thanks.
Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, yes, continue.
Good afternoon, everyone. I, Khushi Sharma, Vice Chair, IEEE VSIT Student Branch, would like to thank Dr. Irfan Langle for being a part of Mindfulness webinar series and explaining the topic with utmost care to all the students. I would also like to express my gratitude towards the Principal of VSIT, Dr. Rohini Kelkar, Vice Principal, Mr. Asa Samparawala, and the management of Vidyalankar Dhanan P Trust, not only for their constant encouragement to conduct more activities, but also making sure we're equipped to conduct them seamlessly. I also thank IEEE Bombay section and all its speakers for joining us in this event and their truly invaluable contribution to it. Sir, this webinar has taught us how storage and analysis of large amounts of data is made possible through cloud computing. Also, how cloud services facilitates an IoT project by enabling support for legacy and smart devices and makes the sharing of reading easier. We will certainly benefit from these learnings. Now, you will find the link to feedback form for this webinar in the chat box. Everybody is requested to fill it before leaving the webinar, so you will receive your e-certificate for participation within 1 week on submission of your feedback. Email will also be sent to you for registered attendees to fill the feedback form in case you miss it here. Please ensure you submit it by today. I would like to thank everyone for being such a wonderful audience and participating actively. It's a delight to organize activities for you all. Thank you. Stay safe.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Irfan sir.
Yes, madam.